you, Southern Baptist, for the privilege of reporting to you today on the work of your National Mission Board. I'm glad to have most of our vice presidents who are representing us today at this convention seated here on the stage with me. Incredibly grateful for the team the Lord has given us. But as I begin my report today, I'm going to ask for your participation. I need your help. Once per month, our overseas missionaries and our stateside staff gather for an online meeting that we call Tuesday, One Team, One Mission, or in acronymish, TOTEM. We've been pre-recording our next meeting while we're here this week in New Orleans. Your missionaries, I believe, would be elated if you, our SBC messengers, would join me in the welcome for that TOTEM meeting. We're filming live right now here in the convention hall, and so I'm going to ask you in just a moment on my cue to simply say in unison, and we'll get it on film, welcome to TOTEM. And then after that, if you have any love to show for your missionaries, how about a round of cheers for them? So let's practice. Here's the cue, and what I need you to say is welcome to TOTEM. This is going to be good. All right, let's go live. Be ready for my cue. Company family, we're glad to be with you today with all of the SB messengers who are a part of this year's denominational meeting. Southern Baptist, you are such a blessing, and I can't even begin to tell you how that is going to ring across the computer screens and the phones and the tablets in the far-flung places on the planet to know they're not there alone. Thank you. God bless you. Thank you for continuing to count the cause of those 3,500 missionaries and their 2,700 children as your own. I hope that you've been able to see our growing desire to serve you and your church. We want those missionaries to you to feel like they are your own, because indeed they are. Through what we call church connections in the last year, every IMB missionary family has been assigned with a list of Southern Baptist churches to cultivate relationships with in order to give your church a very up-close view of what is happening around the world through your missionaries. We want the work that your church is doing to have a name, to have a face, to have a family. And I want to give you an example of what that looks like in one of our missionary families. Toby is a 5-year-old boy and one of your missionary families overseas. He wants to be a part of what his family is doing in church connections. And so Toby has popsicle prayer sticks with the names of the churches that his family has been assigned to connect with. Every evening at the prayer time around the dinner table, Toby will draw out one of the popsicle prayer sticks, and the family will pray for that church specifically. It is our desire to have personal connection between you and your missionaries. If you don't yet know the missionary assigned to your church, please come by our booth, the IMB booth in the exhibit hall, and we'll make that connection for you. We're striving to do a better job in helping personalize the work that you're doing around the world. And let me tell you, it is a great work. Through your record giving, through the Lottie Moon Christmas offering, coupled with over $100 million cooperative program dollars that came last year to the International Mission Board, your missionaries carried out gospel work in 122 countries around the world. There were 21,000 new churches that were birthed, and the gospel was shared with 728,000 people. 178,000 came to faith in Christ, and 102,000 of those new believers were baptized. This is the impact. As we in just a few moments celebrate 79 newly appointed missionaries, we thank God that today at the IMB there are 1,200 missionary candidates working through the appointment process. Yet our joy is held in tension. Our joy is held in tension because we know that spiritual lostness is growing every single day. Your IMB missionaries are addressing the world's greatest problem, that problem of lostness, with God's solution, which is the gospel. But they continue to need your prayers, your support, your continued generosity, and we need more workers in the harvest. That can happen if we continue to work together to raise up more missionaries, calling out the called, and give even more generously through the Lottie offering and the cooperative program. Southern Baptist, I recognize there are countless other overseas sending organizations and groups that your church can support and partner with. And many of them we work with around the world. And we thank God for them and for their impact. But could I remind you today that there is only one missionary sending organization that does work overseas that belongs to you? Dozens of international aid organizations are addressing human problems and bringing relief to human suffering. But not one of those non-denominational ministries or nonprofits doing work overseas ascribes to the Baptist faith and message and answers to the trustees that you appoint from your own churches. There's only one organization that audits its financial statements under your oversight and reports regularly to your SBC Executive Committee and to this annual body. There's only one that sends forth missionaries to share the tenets of the gospel that we fully agree upon and plant churches rooted in Baptist theology and ecclesiology. That one is the IMB. So I have an ask of you today. I'm asking you to keep cheering for the home team, which is the IMB. Let us not forget our collective promise to hold the ropes for those who have left us, those who have said goodbye to their family, to the comforts of this country, to this country itself, to your church family, to answer God's call upon their life. Bringing help and relief, yes, but most importantly, the hope of the gospel to the lost. For 178 years, you have obeyed the Great Commission by sending missionaries overseas through your International Mission Board. But we need more. In 1979, with a world population of 4.3 billion people, just over 3,000 IMB missionaries were under appointment. Since then, the world population has almost doubled, adding 4 billion more people, and yet we've added just 500 more IMB missionaries. In a single decade, between 2008 and 2018, a total of 2,000 of your IMB missionaries came home never to be replaced because of the lack of financial support. Southern Baptists are investing more than $1 billion every year in shoeboxes, child sponsorships, and other non-Baptist causes. We cannot tell our own sons and daughters we can't afford to send your beautiful feet to the nations to proclaim the gospel simply because a non-Baptist group spends more on marketing while we are committed to spending more on the work. A Mississippi Baptist pastor rightly told me when I came into my role, "Mr. President, everything the IMB needs, more money and more missionaries, is in our churches. But you're going to have to ask for it." Southern Baptist, I'm asking for it. I'm asking for more commitment, more sacrifice, more investment in what we do together, because I believe in what we do together. And my prayer is that God would open the floodgates, send us 400 more missionaries under appointment before the end of this year, and ensure that we have the resources to fund them. Despite the challenges that we face in our convention, and listen, I am not ignorant of those challenges or unaware of those challenges, but despite those challenges, we must remain unified in addressing the world's greatest problem. Southern Baptists, we faced challenges before. In fact, it was in 1866 with 244 messengers instead of the thousands that are gathered here today. The Southern Baptists gathered for their annual meeting in Russellville, Kentucky. At that annual meeting, the future of the SBC was far more in doubt than some think it is today. The IMB, for example, had closed its financial books at the end of the previous year with $1.78 in its accounts. And a committee, therefore, was appointed at the annual meeting in 1866 to study this question. Can and should foreign missions continue to be a part of Southern Baptist work? Can you imagine that we would even ask that question? The committee did its work. And reporting back on that work, I want to share with you an excerpt from the 1866 study committee of the Southern Baptist Convention. They wrote and reported, "Our fears are not our counselors. God and duty are our guides. Where shall we begin retraction? Every spot on the field is assigned for our toil. What soil is too sterile for the seed? What fortress too strong for the victories of grace? What hovel is too poor to yield a jewel for Jesus? Where may Christians pause this side of a completed harvest? Though few and poor as the fishermen of Galilee, our hearts, our hopes, our faith must encompass the world." Amid human exigencies and impossibilities, the voice of God urges, "Go forward." 'Tis His to open a passage through the deep waters. 'Tis ours to move onward. We can discern but one command. We realize but one trust. We are burdened with but one duty. We feel but one desire in this work. Go forward, and through God, we will obey. Brothers and sisters, they didn't quit. They moved forward. Thank you for not quitting. The world has a problem, and we know the solution. Let's go forward together to ensure that the world knows a solution by introducing the lost to Jesus. He is the hope of the world. Mr. President, that completes my report. Thank you for the generosity of the time, and I would entertain any questions.
Player Chitwood, you had a little trouble watching the pitch clock. I know that's new this year. And so anyway, because the IMB report went a little bit long, we're actually going to give 3 extra minutes for you to ask questions of the IMB. And so, microphone 1A, state your name, your church, and your question.
Hello, my name is Corey Bing with Sojourn Baptist Church in Oak Ridge, North Texas. I would like to ask, First of all, great job with the jersey. That's an awesome looking jersey. Dr. Chitwood, in light of the IMB forcing vaccination on all its missionaries and the Journal of American Medical Association report finding a 13,200% increased risk of myocarditis, would you like to apologize for forcing missionaries to vax or leave the field? And is the IMB willing to assume responsibility and provide care for any long-term health complications?
Thank you for that question. The decision at the International Mission Board to require vaccinations of our missionaries was a decision that was made many decades ago. It was a time when Southern Baptist missionaries packed their goods in caskets, and they boarded ships with those caskets. The assumption was, because it was a safe assumption, that their time on the field would be short-lived, because they would soon be introduced to diseases and plagues that their immune system was not prepared to respond to. And in fact, your very first Southern Baptist missionary pointed to China at the annual meeting of this convention in 1845, the first meeting. He boarded a ship in 1846 and headed for China. Within a year, his funeral took place as he died from disease he was exposed to in China. We are blessed today because of the miracles of modern medicine to send missionaries to the world who are prepared to die if exposed to disease their body cannot fight off, but who typically don't have to because they receive a long list of vaccinations before they go. It's simply a requirement of serving with the IMB. Obviously, the situation with COVID was incredibly unique. The biggest challenge that we faced as an organization, however, was not a decision of whether or not we would expose our missionaries to a vaccine or have them exposed to a deadly virus, and we did bury missionaries because of COVID. But the biggest question that we had to face was, do missionaries who have said, we'll give our lives to share Christ among the nations, do they, having been required to stay in their place of service by that country to have a vaccine, do they get the vaccine? And because we were facing a situation where we would have lost access to more than 2 billion lost people without the vaccine, we made a very difficult decision to require our team members to be vaccinated, not just our missionaries overseas, but those of us who travel overseas to visit with them. It was the only way to protect gospel access. That was a short-lived requirement because within months, countries began to lower the standard, change the rules, and we were able to maintain access without the COVID vaccine. It's no longer a requirement today.
Microphone 3A, please state your name, your church, and your question.
Yes, my name is Josh Koenig. I'm a messenger from Emmanuel Community Church. Dr. Chitwood, Kevin Azell just explained how they put accountability measures in place when they count the number of new churches that NAM has planted. I'm incredibly thankful to hear of 21,000 churches planted last year alone by the IMB. But my question is, what measures does the IMB have in place when they count new churches?
Yeah, that's a very important question. Thank you, brother, for that question. The IMB operates, of course, by the Baptist Faith and Message. That gives us a fairly clear definition of church. But we also have a foundations document that guides the missiology of every part of the IMB work. That's available on our website. You can get that hard copy. You can download electronic copy. One of the things that is stipulated in that foundations document are the 12 characteristics a healthy church. And so that those are the standards. If you look at those 12 marks, those are the standards that we're looking for in healthy churches around the world. We don't see them observed in every Southern Baptist church, we don't yet see them observed in every church overseas. However, there is a standard, clear definition of what constitutes a local church instead of a group or a fellowship or some gospel meeting. And our missionaries are very well aware, they're very well trained in that, and that is the standard which they use in reporting. With regard to the number of churches that are planted, I think it would be the messengers would want to know that those are churches that are planted by our IMB missionaries or by their national partners, their Baptist partners around the world. There's more than 140 Baptist unions and conventions we work with, and many, many more networks in places where there aren't, you know, Baptist conventions and unions. And so we report on their church planting efforts as well, but only when our missionaries have eyes on that work and they're able to see. There are actually many, many thousands more churches that are planted every year by Baptists around the world that we don't count. We could count them. We choose not to because, for the sake of integrity, we want to ensure that the work is sound and that those churches meet a standard definition. So the missionaries have to have their eyes on the work before they can report it. I also let you know that our trustees have recently taken a trip to audit a group of hundreds of churches that were counted as church plants last year, just to see, okay, or is the standard being met? Are these real churches? Is our reporting good and sound? And they came back with an overwhelmingly positive report.
Okay. Yes, go ahead. The time for questions has expired. I'm so excited. One of the things that you guys had said in feedback about our annual meeting was that we should make sure that we had plenty of time to conduct the business of the convention. I want to tell you, what we're about to do is the business of the convention. So I need to do one little item of business before we start the IMB sending celebration, and that is I am passing the gavel to First Vice President Victor Chayas Arisaban. And he is going to be conducting the meeting from here to the end of the meeting, or the end of this session. So, thank you. Chair recognizes Dr. Paul Chitwood and the IMB.